every single thing that you've gone through equips you to be able to do what you were born to do. Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. So today I want to talk to you about the fact that your purpose involves other people. Okay, doesn't that sound like the most obvious thing? But I think we might underestimate the truth that our purpose and each life assignment within our purpose always involves other people. At least for me, I tend to think about what I'm doing, what my goals are, what I want to accomplish. And I think I'm not the only one who sees issues with other human beings, challenges, misunderstandings, all those kind of things as interference to the fulfillment of my goal. Or maybe some people look at it like interference in their happiness. And the reality is, I think that all of those interactions are part of it, part of the program. So since we know that people are an inherent part of our lives, part of our purpose, let's be deliberate about what we want from the people in our lives, the kind of people we want in our lives. So don't we all want people who are patient with us? Maybe when we're not at our best, we want people to understand. We want people who understand what we mean, even when we fail to properly communicate or we leave out a detail or whatever. We really hope that people are mind readers and they're really going to get what it is that we're trying to communicate and understand our intention and know that we mean the best. We're not trying to be mean. We're not trying to be rude. Those times that, you know, some kind of a, like something wrong comes out of our mouths and we feel bad. Like we want to be forgiven. We want people to be merciful to us and put up with us when we're not at our best and all those kinds of things. We want people in our lives who are gentle, not harsh with us. We want people to care about us, right? Care about whether or not we get home safely. Care about what's going on in our lives. Care about how we feel. We don't really want people who are just apathetic towards us because they're so wrapped up in themselves and their own lives and their own goals. We really want people to care about not just our physical well-being, our mental well-being, our spiritual, our emotional well-being. And wouldn't it be wonderful if we had people in our lives who are kind and loving and who say just the right things at the right time? But do we have these people in our lives? I think most of us would say no, at least not consistently. The problem with all of this, really the problem everywhere you turn, is human beings. We're the problem. We're all flawed. We all get sick. We all get irritable. We all go through hard things. And when we go through hard things, we don't behave like we would really like to behave. We're not at our best. I think what we really want is we want people in our lives who are gentle and peaceful and patient and loving and kind and generous. What we're really asking for is Jesus. We really want Jesus. Or people who act like Jesus in our lives, in our daily lives, at home, at work, in our neighborhood, in our community, everywhere we go. We want people to be kind and loving, right? So we can't see or feel or hear or touch Jesus, but we do have a clue to what he's like because the gospel accounts tell of the way he lived his life on earth. We know about his character traits because we know that he's the Son of God, and the Bible tells us that the character traits of God are peace and gentleness, patience, kindness, generosity, forbearance, you know, putting up with people who are acting like knuckleheads, mercy and love, all those things. Those are the character traits of God. So those are the character traits of Jesus. So, you know, where I'm going with this is that the Bible says that we're all children of God. Uh-oh. That means we're supposed to operate in the world like Jesus does. So it's on us to be all those things to the people in our lives. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I said it. Instead of hoping that people will treat us properly, we have to be the ones who start it by treating others the way Jesus would, the way we would like to be treated. Mm-hmm. I know, nobody wants that. We want somebody else to do it for us, but the reality is that Jesus took up his cross, literally. And he lived out his life assignment, his purpose, for us. Not for him, did it for us. He paid for our sins to provide a way back to our Father in heaven, to give us an opportunity to have eternity in heaven. We have our free will. We can accept it. We can decide not. But is it so unrealistic to expect that our purpose involves some unpleasant things, even some painful things that we would prefer not to have to do? Things that we would prefer not to have to live through? Jesus prayed that he would be spared from his painful execution. He ended that prayer by adding the caveat, "Your will be done." And then he proceeded to complete the horrifically painful life assignment, which fulfilled the purpose for his life on earth. Let's think about that the next time we're asked to be kind to someone who is just mean and rude, and we'd rather not. And the best we think we can do is just walk away. I mean, if you can't be nice, don't say anything at all. But I think we're called to a higher standard of living. I think we're called to a higher place. I think we're called to lean in with kindness and love toward people who we disagree with, toward people who don't treat us well, toward people who don't vote the same way that we vote, toward people who make choices for their lives that we never would. We can be the kind of people we want in our lives, and hopefully in living that way, we will be modeling that behavior for the people within our influence. When we do that, God expands our influence. So as we're doing these things, assuming that we accept the challenge, accept God's purpose for our lives, it helps to be praying for God to soften the hearts of the other people in our life to whom we're called to show love and kindness and mercy and all those things, and to lead them into his purpose for their life. Because if they respond to that, maybe they'll reciprocate and be kind to you and loving in return. Whether they do or not, we're called to do this. Living out God's purpose for our lives is not about what other people can do for us. In fact, we're supposed to be good, expecting absolutely nothing in return. And you may be saying, but I have needs. I need somebody to take care of me. Yes, God knows your needs, and he's capable of meeting those needs. You don't need a human being to come along and meet all of your needs. No human being can do that. No one but God is qualified to do that. When you behave the way you wish that other people would behave towards you, you attract other loving, kind, patient, peaceful, generous people into your life. They may not be the ones who are with you now. But trust God to bring the right people into your life, and he will. When we do this, when we behave like this, live like this, we improve the world wherever we go. Wherever we wind up becomes a better place because people are exposed, sometimes for the first time, to kindness and gentleness and generosity and love. Just living right, righteous living in front of other people is so incredibly powerful. It's transformational, really. I like what C.S. Lewis said, that we don't need more Christian books. We need more Christians writing great books. We can extrapolate that out to say that we don't need more Christians beating people over the head with scripture. What we need is more Christians who are leaders in the community. We need more Christians who are on the school board. We need more Christians who are in banking and social work and small business, in every walk of life, living out the love of Christ with the people around them, showing the evidences of God's spirit of gentleness and patience and peace and kindness and love and generosity and mercy and all those things in their daily interactions, not just on Sunday morning. It's great to invite somebody to your church, but it's far more powerful to just live in front of them in the way that we're called to live. That's our purpose. To take the characteristics of God with us into every walk of life, every industry, every work, every family, every neighborhood, every community, everywhere we go. Whatever your specific life assignments are and whatever your overall purpose is, it has to do with being the very best possible version of yourself that you can be. And that involves a willingness to go through some uncomfortable things, some hard things, maybe even some painful things, with faith that God will use you in a powerful way, with hope for a good future that it'll all work out somehow, some way, and with love that heals hearts and souls and personalities. Your purpose involves trusting God to get you through whatever it is that you're going through or will ever go through. It's all about carrying his light, his love, his peace, his joy, his patience, his gentleness, his generosity, his mercy everywhere you go. That means putting up with mean people with a smile and a good attitude. I know you can do it. That's it for this week. I'll see you next week. If you've missed any of these podcasts, please go back and listen to all the ones that talk about your clues, the clues to your specific life assignments and purpose. There's nothing more important than doing this, than living out your perfect purpose. The things that you've been through have changed the way you see the world. They've qualified you to do what you were born to do and perfectly matched to do Is there anything more important than finding and living the purpose for which you were born? I don't think so. I think that's the point.